here. We had to raise this because I'm shortly going to be introducing Jonathan. Hey, Jonathan, come here. Jonathan's going to be giving the message, but part of the reason we're doing this is there's times when I can't be here, and so we were trying to find a stunt double for me. Okay, so, yeah, we're good. Okay. Well, I had such a nice surprise this morning coming in here to Community Hour. I met part of our church, Jill and Mel here. We don't usually single people out, but you're okay. Raise your hand. But they're part of, I guess, the Church of Christ at Highlands in Arizona. They follow our podcast, and they know more about what's going on in here than most of you do. So, welcome. It's really fun to hear from different communities around the world that are kind of connected in with what's going on in Thailand. So I think with the ethos, we need to create something that welcomes people from non-Denver sites. But as it is, these things we have in common with one another, and it's the ethos that we greet each other every Sunday. Married, divorced, or single here, it's one family that mingles here. Conservative or liberal here, we've all got to give a little here. Big or small here, there's room for us all here. Doubt or believe here, we all can receive here. Gay or straight here, there's no hate here. Woman or man here, everyone can here. Whatever your race here, for all of us, grace here. It's in imitation of the ridiculous love that Almighty God has for each of us and all of us, that we choose to live in love without labels. Amen?
Yeah. Amen.
Well, so, Jonathan, my stunt double, you know, we've been doing this series during Lent. I'm not taking it seriously. We've been doing this series in Lent about passionate living, and we've been clear that the word passion is, as we're using it, goes back to the Greek pasco, to suffer. What means so much to you that you would gladly endure a trial, face suffering, make sacrifices, rather than live in a world without that which means the most to you? That's the passion of Christ. That's the passion of people who follow Christ and his passion. And we've been following that through the lives of some of the various saints. And saints are not just the people who, get officially selected by the Roman Catholic Church. We're including those. But in that category, it needs to be proven that you have done 3 miracles in your life, and only 2 of them can be card tricks. So not everybody gets sainthood. But in the scripture, it says, to all those sanctified by the blood of Christ, those are the santos, those are the saints. And so we're talking about saints among the saints, and we're inspired by those who have lived passionately the calling of God in their life. And so this morning I'm going to call on St. Jonathan to talk about St. James. Right there?
Yeah.
All right, well, word of the same prayer.
Yeah,
thank you. Lord, our God, thank you for Jonathan and for that true passion that wells up within him. To follow you, to serve you, to serve others, that your greater glory might be seen here on earth. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Mark. All right, here we go. I would love if everyone would take 15 to 20 seconds and just close your eyes with me. Represent to you? Do you actually picture the foot moving from heel to toe? What did you see around you when you were hearing the footsteps? How fast were things moving next to you? Was someone at your side? There is something so fundamental and simple about walking, and especially walking alongside. When we take a moment to look at our church's mission statement, how do we interpret walking humbly? How does this connect to our everyday life? What does this really look like, tangibly speaking, walking humbly, in the moment, with our friends and our families, in the challenges and the stresses? How do we practically build that out? Physically walking is only one way to interpret this. It holds better space as a metaphor. I think of walking humbly as space, pace, and presence. Creating space to be unhurried and alongside a loved one, a new friend, or someone you've never met. Moving at a pace to make time for lying up against a tree and smelling the flavor of fresh baked bread, or allowing the wind to wrap itself completely around your neck. The presence in holding time in a careful, reflective place, in a loving way, truly believing that time is in fact precious. Jesus and his disciples walked alongside, literally and metaphorically, throughout all of the New Testament. Did you know that it's roughly 90 to 115 miles between Judea and Galilee? Which could be 5 to 7 days of walking. Walking was an integral part of everyday life in this time. And for most of the world's people, it still is. How often in one day do we knowingly or mostly unknowingly counteract this built-in design to walk among? I'm going to talk with you about a saint that inspires hundreds of thousands of people each year from all over the world to grow closer to God, to other, and to self through pilgrimage. He is mysterious and largely unknown, as there is little written about his existence here on earth. Most of what we know that's written about St. James is taken from illuminated manuscripts written in the medieval times, more specifically between the 7th and 12th centuries. Numerous characters in the Christian faith spring up when talking about the name James or St. James. I will be specifically talking about the Apostle James, son of Zebedee, also known as St. James the Greater. He's known as patron saint of Spain, of pilgrims, of laborers. He was also one of Jesus' first disciples, along with his brother John, the elder. John and James were casting their nets and fishing with their father when Jesus asked them to follow him. The brothers, along with Peter, in many texts, are a part of what's said to be Jesus' inner circle of three, and also noted to be his closest friends. The brothers were also named by Jesus as the Sons of Thunder for the volume of their preaching, which supposedly terrified the wicked, aroused the slothful, and won the admiration of all by its loudness. The story goes that several years after Christ's crucifixion, St. James sailed to the Galatia region, which is now northwest coastal Spain, to commence his ministry amongst the pagan populations that dwelled there. It was common for most of the disciples and the rest of the early Christian church to seek such sites to inspire their message. He returned to Jerusalem years later, and it wasn't long before the Pharisees felt threatened by his presence and his ministry. In 43 AD, shortly at 10 years after Christ's crucifixion, he was charged, dragged by a rope, and delivered to be beheaded by King Herod Agrippa I. He was the first of the 12 disciples to fall to martyrdom. Following his martyrdom, his disciples took his body back to Lebrija, now Santiago, Spain. Just over 800 years passed, and time grew over these events. Much was forgotten, until a hermit named Pelagio received a vision revealing the tomb of St. James. On July 25th of 812, a bright light filled the area where the tomb was revealed, thus had the name Compostela, or Field of Light. Now you have Santiago de Compostela. Santiago meaning St. James, Compostela, Field of Light, which is now the popular destination in northern Spain. St. James is most known throughout the world for his miracles and presence along a series of paths leading pilgrims from various countries, mostly in Europe,
to his burial site in Santiago de Compostela. The pilgrimage is called El Camino de Santiago, or Way of St. James. His legacy and ultimate sacrifice as a bold missionary and close friend of Jesus moves throughout the Camino. The pilgrimage to St. James reached its peak in 12th century. Small pilgrim towns, now larger towns and cities, popped up all along the path to support the hundreds and thousands of pilgrims that made their way. They would leave from their front door, whether from France, Germany, Portugal, and with nothing but the clothes on their back. In these times, it was practiced that illness was the result of a spiritual problem, and that there were many miracles and benefits to be found on the pilgrimage, especially when praying to St. James. Many would take on this journey to obtain a cure for themselves or someone they love. Since the majority of pilgrims in these times left from their home, reaching the cathedral in Santiago was only halfway. They would pick up their Compostela, their certificate for accomplishment, and have to walk back. Modern pilgrims take buses, trains, and planes. Still counts. What does this look like for us today? To leave with nothing but the clothes on your back. For God, for self, for other. To grow spiritually with nothing but the clothes on your back. How do we relate to that today? What does that look like? How do we integrate intention like this as a church with just the clothes on our back? The main Camino path is known as the Camino Francis. It's roughly 490 miles in length and takes pilgrims an average of 30 to 40 days. The traditional route starts in St. Jean Pied-de-Port in France, just on the north side of the Great Pyrenees Mountains. And after 1 or 2 days' walk, you are on the other side of the Pyrenees and in present-day Spain. The terrain, climate, throughout this entire journey vary. And you have small weight markers in the form of scallop shells and yellow arrows guiding you at every turn. In 1980, there were roughly 10,000 pilgrims walking on this path. Last year, just shy of 200,000. On any given year throughout the medieval times, there were upwards of 300,000 pilgrims walking this path. In October of last year, my father and I walked the Camino de Santiago together. We walked an average of 15 miles a day throughout this incredible part of the world. Kids, adults, and elders welcomed pilgrims along the path. The drumbeat of this northern Spanish region has known pilgrim activity for centuries. That's all they've ever known, is to have people moving through, walking through. Kids would dance around the pilgrims as you walk through the towns. It was awesome. You could throw your backpack right next to a bench where the elders would sit outside of the cafe, and they wouldn't think twice. Waterfront's cafes and hostels nestled themselves within and around the many ruins and medieval foundations, giving memory to the hard past of warfare between medieval kingdoms. We, pilgrims, would raise our glasses to celebrate our miles. We stopped to mend one another's blisters, and we greeted almost every passing being with "Buen Camino, good way." My greatest memories are the ones that involve walking alongside new friends, and those of watching my father connect to God in ways I believe he never thought possible. I'll never forget the way he clung to the worn gates of the cathedral for 30 minutes after we finished and arrived to Santiago. It affirmed just how grounded life can be when space, pace, and presence become a priority. We weren't racing, avoiding, or expecting. We were connecting, growing, and existing. In the movie The Way, the son Emilio Estevez supposedly dies after his first day walking up the Great Pyrenees. It's a tough climb and sure to test the faint of heart. I remember that first day clearly, 18 miles up, down, and around this beautiful mountainside, misty and gorgeous. Breathing in the historical route and the heart it carried for so many was inspiring, right from the start. I remember seeing a woman walking behind me as I started. She was very stiff and serious and focused. I also noticed her because she was wearing a tank top and shorts, and it was freezing. I'm like, what are you doing? But it was the first day, so I wasn't going to, you know, get in her way. She had her earphones in, and she was on a mission. I stopped to take a break where the path seemed to split. You couldn't see more than 7-10 feet in front of you because the fog was covering up everything. She looked at me and tilted her head, assuming that I knew the way forward. I saw pilgrims walk the one direction, so I pointed to that direction, and she carried on. As I continued walking, I saw this woman up on the hill, just past another hill. She was pretty far away. She kind of made her way off the trail a little bit. But it looked like she was picking something and eating something, and it really piqued my curiosity. I was in no rush and curious about what she had found, and I somewhat pranced up behind her. I really did. If you can even imagine or picture that. She was startled. It freaked her out a little bit. I asked her what she was doing, and in her beautiful Slavic tone, she said, "I pick fresh mountain blueberries. See, you try." She was quick to immediately throw out her hand and say, "I'm Sabina from Slovenia." Wow, what a handshake. It was one of those moments where I wish I would have prepared mentally to have grasped tough in response, to appear confident as a man with that handshake. My hand was not prepared, and it felt squishy in her grasp. I admit it was a weak moment. We picked blueberries for 20 minutes together and hardly said a word. We would follow the other to the next and best bush that had the fullest and largest supply. What a great memory. How often do we protect time to be with one another? With those we love, with those we care about, or those we've just met, affirming our connection to them without words. It was natural for us to get up and continue walking together. We talked for 11 miles until we reached our destination. We talked about Slovenia, her family, her hopes, and her reason for walking the Camino. I got to know this incredible woman throughout the entire journey, through walking, riding, eating, and singing. We ran into each other almost every day on this, which was rare and hard to do, and it just happened. After a couple days of getting to know each other, within the first week, she painted 2 5x7 watercolor paintings for me, one of a pilgrim and one of a medieval bridge we'd walked by the day before. I'll never forget one night when about 50 pilgrims gathered in a courtyard of a cozy hostel. The innkeepers played the guitars and they started to sing with everyone. We came out of our rooms, out of the showers, and out of fixing our feet. We all gathered and were encouraged to sing a song representing our country. Germany, Italy, France, Spain, Portugal, South America, South Africa, China, all different countries started singing. And I saw, and I got up, and I was the one American, and I could not think of a song, and I'm like, ah! So I saw, but I was proud. I sung Amazing Grace for everyone, and it was awesome after the first minute of awkwardness. And I saw Sabina sitting in the back corner of this courtyard, kind of in the shadows, hiding from the opportunity to represent her country and herself and this newfound faith that she was finding on the Camino. And so I kind of targeted her. And I said, "Sabina, come up." And she's like, "No, no, God, no." And, you know, she's putting her hands in front of her face. She's trying to hunker down into her chair a little bit more. And I continued to nudge. She grabbed the cooking whisk, which was our microphone, somewhat aggressively, and sang the most beautiful song in her language. The Camino transformed the hardness of this woman in the first days, transformed the hardness of her first days. Sabina was smiling and exuded a light that spoke of freedom, color, and newfound faith. She was in her 50s, a mother of three, and carried a burden of hard times with her recently deceased mother and her immediate family. She lost faith in the church, but felt the Camino was giving her a chance to find it again, She wept in the cathedral after completing the journey, as most of us did. We talked for hours on those last days in detail about how we would carry the Camino back home with us. There are people like Sabina all around us, picking blueberries. How can more of our days travel at a pace where we can listen and get to know the neighbor we've never talked to or the woman at the bus stop? You don't have to prance behind them, but it would be interesting if you did. Pilgrimage defined as simply a journey of moral or spiritual intention, traditionally on foot to a religious site or shrine, connected to a person's beliefs or faith traditions. When dissected more fully, it's a metaphysical journey within to reconcile the pain of the past or give of oneself for the hope of spiritual growth. Three years ago today, I was on day three, March 1st. I was on day three, March 3rd, first day was March 1st, of my own version of pilgrimage. I walked west from the Atlantic Ocean all the way to the Pacific for 8.5 months. I was gone for 242 days, and I stayed with over 120 strangers. Their smiles and their stories are deeply embedded. I was generating support for a nonprofit called Kiva, which helps small businesses start small loans all over the world and here in the U.S. I got up every day and I walked. I stayed in barns, bedrooms, sheds, ditches, underpasses, porches, front yards, fields, valleys, mountain slopes, by creeks, lakes, rivers, highways, parks, and forest. I was invited to eat at the table with sinners, strangers, and some of the most beautiful people I've ever met. All kinds, shapes, colors, backgrounds, beliefs, political, religious, orientation, gender, ethnic, income, job, no job, family, alone, widowed, isolated, divorced, abused, neglected, forgotten. There was a deep call to this journey that fueled all of the events I just listed. In my late teens and very early 20s, I was beyond lost, consumed with insecurity, and far from feeling capable. The pain of hiding and a hard hunger for personal control were bursting at the seams. Life's turbulence began threatening the walls I had worked so hard to build. They started to shatter and crumble. Christ and his church found their way into my pain when I was 22. This deep spiritual relationship broke me as I fought to love myself and others the way Christ loved me. The values of the Christian faith began weaving into my world. This relationship has forever changed my life. A few years passed from those really high times of change, and I really started wrestling with the great tensions between things of God and things of the world. I was unsatisfied in not being as close to God the way I was when I deeply depended on him years back. I was seeking. I wanted to grow. I came across the book A Walk Across America by Peter Jenkins. I read that book in a day, and with tears and heartburn, I was sold. Paul's encouragement of humility and unity to the Philippians in chapter 2:1 describes this deeper call so well. Philippians 2:1-2. If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship from the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, and being one in spirit and in purpose. I want us to sit with that for a few seconds. Being one in spirit and in purpose. Those words felt like thunder in my stomach. demanding attention and purpose. How can I make the joy of Christ complete? What does this statement represent? For us as a church? For your family? For your relationships? For you? Each of you? In your deepest places? Of course, to do this long walk and listen to these words, vibrations, callings, meant letting go of a lot, as well as denouncing this growing cynical behavior that was all around me, telling me to categorize and compartmentalize the people I didn't agree with or understand, or those that didn't agree with me or understand me. God taught me over and over to believe that His Son, His Spirit, is inside of us all. We are born with His Spirit. We are all connected. I heard those words. I believed them. The ways of the world make it hard. Our growing demand to sit down and be inside all hours of the day make it hard. Growing stresses, obligations, speeds of travel, and our calendars make it hard. I fought with time and with the comfort that I had in these things. The voices got louder and I faced a choice. I could board up the voice to keep it muted for a while and carry on, or I could stand tall and, as Paul charges Timothy from his cell, take hold of the eternal life to which you've been called, to fight the good fight of the faith. In those words, I felt Jesus simply and deeply saying to me, "Trust me. Do you believe that I am with you? Meet me where I am, as I have met you." Church, the cross-country walk was far from miraculous. It was a simple but difficult choice to support that voice and not board it up. I started walking on March 1st. I held the hand of God oh so tightly as I found myself without shelter, without food, or with the remained sprayed mud off a semi-truck after I swore it was going to hit me. This journey brought me so much closer to Christ, to His people, to His teachings, and to His creation in ways that I'm forever thankful. Church found its place at every dinner table and in every step when walking alongside a friend or stranger. The call to love well and see Christ in everyone has been branded deep. I fall short all the time, but I feel more and more equipped to live this way as I fight to create space, pace, and presence for it. So, what does St. James represent in all this? I believe St. James represents more than just walking on a path for days, weeks, or months at a time, even though I'd like that. He represents the courage to drop the fishing net and walk alongside Jesus, to walk alongside the pain and light that Sabina carried. He represents the embrace of one tired pilgrim to the next. And the hope my father found in church outside the walls. St. James emulates a commitment in trusting and sacrificing for the goodness of truth in everyday life and the battle against things of the world in everyday life. He invites us, always, no matter the path, to carry the burden of hard times alongside one another and to work hard, creating space, pace, and presence to carry us ever so closer to God, to self, and to the stranger. Let us pray. Father, I pray that you meet with us in our deepest places, in our paths, on our journeys, and in all of our interactions with loved ones, those that we care about and those we haven't met. That you're with us in seizing the opportunity to love them and to love ourselves while doing it. Be with us and teach us as a church, as individuals, to walk among and to walk humbly. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus was betrayed. He sat with his friends for supper. He took the bread, and after he gave thanks for it, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, broken for you. Take and eat and remember me."
Later that same night, he took the cup of wine. He held it up and said, This wine is the blood of a new covenant, a promise for the redemption of all people. Take and drink and remember me. Communion servers, would you please come up front? I invite everyone to come and take a piece of the bread or the gluten-free cracker, dip it in the cup, and then eat. Feel free to participate in other ways as well. You may want to grab a black wristband or another color thread to represent the words of St. James. Receive prayer from folks available on the sides of the auditorium. Or pick up an eyedropper of color and add it to our prayer tapestry page. You could come up and write in the journals of thanksgiving or of questions here on the reflection table. And you're just as welcome to stay in your seat and observe. Please, everyone, draw near as you're ready.